today we are going to discuss one of the very important topic, biosphere. We will try to understand the different aspect of biosphere. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in a studio eminent scholar, Professor Dinbandhu Sahu. He was the first Indian student to visit Antarctica during 1987-88 in the 7th Indian Scientific Expedition to Antarctica. He undertook two trips to Arctic during 1991 and 1992, and he also has credit to visiting all the seven continent and five oceans within a record period of 18 months. And Dr. Sahu is a scholar par excellence. He has written a number of books. A few of books are very famous, like one book is Farming the Ocean, Seaweeds Cultivation and Utilization. The other book is Seaweeds of Indian Coast. The other book is Sustainable Aquaculture, Advances in Marine and Antarctic Sciences. Porphyra Harvesting Gold from the Sea, Common Seaweeds of India, Algal Biotechnology and Environment. There are a number of books and number of research papers published in different national and international journals, and convened a large number of conferences, seminars, and contributed what is the Indian perspective and Indian aspect of the biosphere, and try to understand the different region and especially the biosphere in the Indian coast and the Indian biosphere. So I think his knowledge and experience and exposure to the different continent and different five oceans will certainly give us insight and help us to understand the biosphere, and we'll try to explore the different aspects of its today lecture. So on your behalf, I welcome Professor Sahu for the EDUSET lecture on this very topic. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Kumar. Thank you very much. And today I am going to speak on about the biosphere. Yeah. Can I have the first slide?
Slide, please.
So I'll talk about the role, the biosphere and role of algae in biosphere, which is very, very important. And before I start my topic, you know, what you see in this slide in the background is nothing but the biosphere. Now, what is basically the biosphere? The biosphere is the global sum of all ecosystem, which can be, you know, in a very general term, termed as the zone of life on Earth, which is a very, very close system. Take for example, Earth is the complete biosphere, because as we know, there is no other planet on the Earth, no other planet outside the Earth where you have the life. So Earth is a very good system, a very close system, you know, of biosphere. Basically, biosphere is the global ecological system integrating all living beings and their relationship, including their interaction with the elements of the lithosphere, hydrosphere, and atmosphere. Now, when I am talking about this, if you see this slide is showing the atmosphere on the background, and then you have the water, and then you have the lithosphere, the rocks. That in total constitute the biosphere. Now, the biosphere is postulated to have beginning with a process of bioprocess. Now, if you think about the origin of the Earth, all of you are aware about the Big Bang theory. When there was collision, the Earth was created. It was a huge mass, molten mass. And I have seen a 3D film in basically in NASA, where you can see the Earth is a molten mass. And slowly what happens when the earth cools down, there was slowly the water vapor gets condensed, and the first drop of rain comes to the earth. And when you have the first drop of rain, then you have rain, and you have the whole water bodies flows, then the life originated first in these huge water body called ocean. As per report, the life somewhere started around 3.5 billion years ago. And then you have the life slowly moved from the aquatic ecosystem or from the water, then it came to the land. It's a very, very interesting story. I'm not going into the details of that. Now, biosphere, bio means something very living, and biosphere, the term biosphere was coined by a geologist, Edward Suess, in the year 1857. And he defined the biosphere as the place on Earth's surface where the life is there, where the life dwells. So that's basically the biosphere. Now, if you see, if you take the whole Earth, you have the atmosphere, you have the ocean, and you have the land. And in the land, you can see a large number of plants and animals. And also in the ocean, you have also the plants and animals. So all these together, the land, the water, and the atmosphere is constituting the biosphere, where there are a large number of biological organisms. They live in this system. Now, is the biosphere changing? The answer is yes. Now, how the biosphere is changing? Today, we are all talking about the climate change, the global warming, and all these things. So all these phenomenon which is happening in the world, this is because of natural as well as the anthropogenic pressure. Anthropogenic pressure means the pressure which is caused due to the activities of the human beings. And the results of this natural as well as anthropogenic activities is the climate change. Now, let's see whether the climate change is real. Yes, the climate change is real. It's happening. Now, if you see this, a few years back, there was extremely, heat waves, extreme heat waves, which were basically all over the world. Then you have a flood. Then you have now, this year, you might have seen in the newspapers that the temperature in the United States as well as in Europe has drastically gone down, and the temperature somewhere it has gone to minus 53 degrees centigrade. When you have the temperature going to such sub-zero level, the Niagara Falls have frozen. There are many water bodies, massive lakes which have frozen. And you can see the life within this aquatic system is in big danger. Similarly, all of you know that there is a lot of changes which is taking place, and the whole biosphere is getting affected due to this change. So if the climate change is real, now it is happening, we feel it every day. We are feeling that the climate change is real, and we feel it every day, and we are seeing the results. There is heavy rain, there is flash flood, high temperature, unusual snowfall, and short winter. Now, because of that, there is breaking of ice shelf in both Arctic as well as in the Antarctic region. There is melting of ice, there is rise in seawater temperature, and there is acidification of ocean. All of you know that Antarctic has a lot of ice which is being stored in the form of freshwater deposit. And there is so much of increase in the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere which gets dissolved in the ocean, that is causing the acidification of ocean. So these are all quite interrelated and quite complicated phenomenon which is affecting our biosphere. Now, because of the climate change, there is also a decrease in the crop productivity. There is a decline in the fish catch. There is also change in behavior. Not only the change in the behavior of the human beings, but also the change in the behavior of the animals and plants. For example, because of the extreme climatic condition, our behavior is changed. Sometimes when we are feeling extremely hot, if there is a rise in the temperature, we feel extremely hot, we get irritated. That's when we have extremely cold situation, we get also, a depressing phase. So these are the big problems of this. So there is a change in behavior. There is species migration and population migration. Wherever there is a flood, obviously there is a species migration from that particular area. As you know, there is also human population migration because of this climate change. So because of the sum total of the impact of this climate change, we pay a heavy price in terms of economics and social value. So the result is economic and its social consequence. Now if you see this, what did it cost in terms of money? The present world GDP is somewhere around $50 trillion, and the cost of climate change will be something between $2.5 to $10 trillion. That's the economic loss which we'll be facing. Say for example, if you see these beautiful pictures you have here, you can see this is the part of Arctic. The first two slide pictures on the up, you can see it has affected the polar bear, and the two bottom slides are in the Antarctic region. And if you see this, Antarctic as well as the Arctic, Antarctic is in the southern hemisphere, Arctic is in the northern hemisphere. In the northern hemisphere, you will not find any penguins in the Arctic. You will find them in Antarctic region. But the polar bear, which you see, that you find in the Arctic region only, they are also getting affected. And they live in such a pristine condition. And as you might have seen, and read in various newspapers, also seen in the various television channels, that the ice in this region is melting, and the melting of ice in the Arctic region has created a lot of what you call cold storm in the northern atmosphere, where Canada and US are severely affected. Now, if you see this particular slide over here, this is again is a problem. You have this aquatic environment where you can see how the emissions, the burning of the oil and the natural gas is affecting the aquatic life. And you have a shipwreck where you have thousands and thousands of tons of chemicals which are being thrown into the sea. And the impact which you get in the left outside bottom, you can see there is a lot of fish kills. The fish are basically dying, which is part of this aquatic, marine aquatic ecosystem. And you can see the consequence is very severe. The right hand side bottom, you can see a picture which is showing unusual flood. This is a picture which is in the place like Delhi, which is the capital of India. You can see how the city is flooded and the people are just going in the boat. It's a sight to see that how our biosphere is getting affected because of the severe climatic change which is happening. Now, if you see this particular picture, how the these are the different pictures of the globe. You can see in the bottom, you have Antarctic, and then at the extreme right, you can see the impact of global warming. But what we need is a greener Earth. As per report, this Earth is the only biosphere where the life exists. There is no other system or the planet so far where the life or the biosphere is reported. Now, in contrast, this Earth is a natural biosphere. Many years back, I remember the scientist made Biosphere 2. I was lucky to visit the Biosphere 2 in the state of Arizona in the United States of America. And if you see in the Biosphere 2 what type of experiments they have done, they have taken an isolated place and they have left some human beings inside that. They have created an artificial forest, artificial water bodies. They supplied the food for 2 years, and the people lived inside this artificial, what you call the Biosphere 2, for a period of 2 to 3 years, basically replicating an artificial world. So you have Biosphere 1 and Biosphere 2, which is quite artificial, and that's very interesting. Because of the lack of time, I am not going into this. Now, when I'm talking about the biosphere, I'm not going into the details of the ecology or details of the science and various types of theories. How our biosphere or our day-to-day life is getting affected on this planet, and what we can do, that's very, very important. Now, 1.2 billion people in the world are living in a salary of less than $1 per day, less than somewhere around 60 rupees to 70 rupees a day in this world. And there are 23 global risks which are being identified by the World Economic Forum's Global Risk Network, where poverty, unemployment, food security, nutritional security, and global warming are some of the major concern which is affecting all of us. The next slide will tell you, out of these, 6 global risks are key to the India's future. And as you know that India is a rapidly developing economy. In terms of population, we are number 2 in the world. Now, these 6 global risks, which is key to the India's future, were water shortage, oil shocks, that is energy deficit, mass unemployment, food and nutritional security, HIV/AIDS, climate change, or global warming are going to play. These are the major concern. These 6 factors are the major concern for all of us. Now, this is because of a simple gas called carbon dioxide. As I have told you in the beginning, the Earth is at the risk because of the climate change. And this is happening because of the increase in the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Now, the level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere has increased by 31% since the year 1750, that is where the industrialization started. That's the data which is available in the literature. Now, presently, 7.4 billion tons of carbon dioxide is released to the atmosphere per year, now which may increase to 20 billion tons by the year 2100. So, over the last 2 decades, only 50% of the released carbon dioxide remain in the atmosphere. 20% are taken by the terrestrial biosphere. And then you have the carbon dioxide which gets absorbed into the sea. Now, since the beginning of the industrial era, the oceans have absorbed around 127 billion metric tons of carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Remember, only 20% of this is being absorbed by our terrestrial forest and terrestrial biosphere, but most of it is being absorbed by the ocean. Nearly 22 million metric tons of carbon dioxide is being absorbed by the ocean every day. If the ocean doesn't absorb this carbon dioxide, then the carbon dioxide remains in the atmosphere, and which is a major problem. Now, because of there is so much of carbon dioxide which gets absorbed by the ocean, the pH of the seawater has changed. Because of the change in the of the seawater, pH in the seawater, this has affected basically a large number of marine life. And all of you know that the seawater is slowly getting higher temperature. The temperature of the seawater is increasing day by day. Now, since the temperature of the seawater is increasing, this is creating a lot of problems. Now, if you see this slide, because of the rise in the atmospheric temperature, in the seawater, the ice shelf in the Antarctica is slowly breaking down. You can see in this particular slide, can I have the slide? You can see this at the bottom, there is a small iceberg which is there. These icebergs are being formed because the ice shelf of Antarctica gets broken away. When I am talking about the ice shelf, that's quite huge in size, and as it drifts, it slowly changes its shape, and one third of this iceberg is visible, two third remains under water. You can see this is another picture of the area. This is a beautiful picture of the ocean biosphere, where you have in the ocean system the whole of the sea gets frozen, and then slowly as the temperature increases, the ice are broken into these small pieces. So coming back to India, what are the problems? 18% of the world population, India has nearly 18% of the world's population, but only 4% of water resources. So the water resources are very very limited in India, and we have to supply fresh water. So drinking water is a big problem. If you go to big cities like in Delhi or Chennai or other places, you see how valuable is water, and how the street fight or the water riots break out in many of the places. So we have to be very, very careful about the conservation of this fresh water, which is very, very important. India has a relatively youth population. We need to find out the employment for nearly 71 million people in the next 5 to 10 years. All of you know, because the quality of life has changed, so we need to create employment for the younger generations, which is very, very important. Now, for this, what do you do? You need to find out alternate technology to create new employments, to provide sustainable source of energy. So how do you provide that technology, which is alternate technology? Now, a technology can be only successful if it has this 4A. The technology should be available to the common people. The technology should be affordable, because if it is expensive technology, nobody will take it. The technology should be accessible, and it should be appropriate. If out of these 4A, if 1A is missing, then basically this will not work, the technology will be a failure. Now, as a biologist, we need to have sustainable utilization of these bioresources for our own survival and for the survival of the entire life system. Now, how do you do that? You need to do climate bioengineering. Now, when I'm talking about this, you can see this is a schematic view. What do you have? You have the water bodies, like massive water bodies like ocean or lakes, as you can see, and the phytoplankton which lives in this water body, they basically take sunlight, use carbon dioxide and water, and they, because of a process called photosynthesis, they produce enough amount of biomass. So these basically the biomass which sequester the carbon dioxide is very important for the sustainable development, for our own survival, which is very, very important. Now, what the people are doing, say, for example, to give you one small example, now people are talking about biodiesel or biofuel. All of you know that. We are running various types of vehicles, the automobiles or the ships. Now, it requires enormous amount of energy. Now, what the people are doing in the Western world, they are basically using a large number of food crops such as soybean, palm oil, sunflower, corn, even the sugarcane, which is a good source of alcohol to run the vehicle. So they are using all these plant products for the production of oil or the biofuel or what you call the biodiesel or bioethanol to run the vehicles. Now, when you have that, the problem is long-term sustainability. Can we afford, as there are a large number of people, millions of people around the world are staying hungry, and people are running their vehicles with the help of converting this food. So what it is doing is there is indiscriminate damaging of the forest, of the terrestrial ecosystem. Now, not only this creates a huge environmental problems, but also it creates a lot of social problem in the long run. When people are staying hungry, people are not getting enough amount of food, how can you run the vehicles by converting the food into this thing? So you need a new source of raw materials. The new source of raw material is basically is algae. Now, just before going into that, if you see that, this is the global demand of supply of various types of biofuels. I am not going, this is a very interesting slide, so when I am talking about, because energy is very, very important. Now, in the search of energy, we are destroying our habitats, the pristine ecosystems. Now, the reality is, when you try to convert these biological resources, from soybeans, you get only 446 liters of oil per hectare per year. From rapeseed, you have 119. From mustard oil is very important. This is an edible oil. We get only 1,300 liters of oil per hectare. And then you have jatropha, then you have palm oil. Palm oil gets something around 5,950 liters of oil. Now, algae, which is basically a microscopic aquatic plants, it can give you a huge amount of bio oil. Say, for example, at the lowest yield, it can give you around 45,000 liters of oil. And if you are using very high quality algae, it will give you 1,37,000 liters of oil per hectare per year. So when you are using the algae, they are basically not destroying the ecosystem. Besides giving the oil, algae can be a very good source of ethanol. Now, this slide is very, very important. Why algae should be used as a source of energy or a source of food or a source of carbon dioxide sequestration. Algae is the most promising biodiesel feedstock because of its rapid growth rate, quickest time to harvest compared to other biofuel foodstock. It doesn't have any competition with food. It doesn't require any land, arable land. You can have it in the wasteland. And then it has several environmental benefits, like it is non-toxic, highly biodegradable. It's when it burns, it doesn't emit any carbon dioxide, safe fuel for general use. It also captures carbon dioxide. It consumes the carbon dioxide from various types of source. And per hectare yield is much, much higher compared to other areas. Now, it's not that simple just to take out the material from the our ecosystem and directly use it. It involves a lot many steps. Now, if you take these routes to algal biofuels, it has microalgae as well as the macroalgae. Microalgae are basically small organisms which are not visible to the naked eyes. Macroalgae are organisms which are large in size. Microalgae can give you hydrogen, biological hydrogen, can give you ethanol, and it can give you large amount of lipids which you can convert into to produce biodiesel. Whereas the large size sea algae, the algae which the plants which grow in the sea, they are rich in carbohydrates, so they can give you huge amount of ethanol, methane, and other this thing. Now, when you try to use these biological resources, now these biological resources has to be used judiciously. And it has several steps. It requires science, it requires engineering, and also you need to have scale-up strategy. This is very, very important. If you see this, now, first you need to study the biology, the biology of the organism. Once you find out that, once you studied the biology of that organism, then you must go for its cultivation, because in the whole supply chain management system, you need to cultivate huge amount of these algae. Then you need to harvest it, then you need to extract it, and then it will go to the fuel production. This is how you start the things in the ecosystem. Starting from the raw material, you can go up to the final product. Now, what do you get out of this? When you convert these algae and you process this, you get biofuels, you get fertilizer, you get animal feeds, food supplement, recombinant proteins, pharmaceuticals, nutraceuticals, specialty chemicals, and also it helps in water remediation and carbon dioxide mitigation. So these are the benefits which you get from the algae. Now the next slide, the algae means it is the aquatic plant, or what you call in Hindi is kai. Now you can get a large number of beautiful products which you can see, you can use it in your day-to-day life, whether it's any type of food or chemicals or fertilizer. You can see even the cosmetics which are being extracted from these algae. Now, if you consider the whole aquatic biomass, because algae are mostly aquatic organisms, there are 30,000 microalgal species, out of which only 3 to 4 are commercially exploited so far. During the 1960, the chlorella, which is a single cell algae, this is being used, all of you know, for the space travel. When the people went to space, they carried out, they carried with them the chlorella tablets and they ate it because it's a very rich source of protein. During 1970, you have spirulina, and spirulina is a very, very good source of food, rich in various types of chemicals, proteins, beta-carotene, so it is one of the best food. Then in 80s, you have Dunaliella, which is another microscopic algae. In 90, in Haematococcus, and 2000s, you have Porphyra and Nanochloropsis. So the basic idea is, in the aquatic ecosystem, you get a large number of aquatic organisms, but only few you can use for the commercial purpose. Now, when you go for the commercial process, the process is not that simple. So you need to have a system, as you can see in this chart. You have carbon dioxide and waste heat coming into this. It goes to a bioreactor, and then you have lipids and other things which is being taken out, and then you get to the value system. This is a very interesting slide. If you see this, there is a single cell organism called Haematococcus. It has two flagella, and as you increase the temperature as well as the light of to this organism, you can see slowly it has retracted its flagella and accumulating a huge amount of pigments and slowly turning reddish. And at the end of this stage, you can see the whole green cell has become completely red. This is a survival or an adaptation mechanism where the plants have accumulated huge amount of these red color lipids, and that is called astaxanthin, and that is being commercially used. This slide, you can see that how a single organism has created a huge industry in this. Now, what we have been doing in our laboratory at Delhi University, we are collecting algae from not only different parts of the country, but also from different parts of the world. We are isolating these and culturing these, and then producing in a large scale so that we can utilize this. If you see this particular slide, you can see that how oil is being formed inside the plant cells. We have been collecting these algae from different parts, and you can see these are the different colors of algae, and we take it and we study it in our laboratory, and you can see these are wonderful colors, and they have very, very high value when you try to commercially exploit this. I'm not going into the details. Say, for example, this is a very, very interesting photobioreactor which is being installed in a power plant to take the carbon dioxide from the power plant and feed this into this plant. You can see this has become green. So it takes the carbon dioxide from the power plant, and we put the algae inside this, and it grows inside this, and it helps in the sequestration of carbon dioxide. I think I will stop it here for today. If you have any question, you must ask me the question related to this particular topic in the biosphere. And that's very, very important. This is a very beautiful slide which I have shown you at the end, which tells you that the biosphere is so beautiful, and it has so many things. If we don't preserve it, then it will damage all of us. Already we have damaged a large number of species, a large number of important organisms in this biosphere. We need to preserve it. This is a very, very small way where we can go for the sustainable utilization of one resources for the benefit of the mankind to preserve our biosphere for the future.
Okay, so what the other solution you suggest there because of degradation and all this?
Well, there are many types of living organisms.
Mm-hmm.
This is one organism which is present inside the water. You have a large number of beneficial bacteria.
Mm.
You have a large number of higher plants which is having a lot of value. So we must go for that. Many things are yet to be explored from this biosphere.
Okay.
We call it Biosphere 1. The world is basically the Biosphere 1.
Mm-hmm. So what could have been the result of the, you were talking about the artificial biosphere created and try to put a life into, bring some.
Now what they have done is they have created artificial globes. Exactly it is a artificial globe and it has it is made up of glass and inside they have made the forest and they have left some animals and they have left few human beings. I mean, human beings means scientists to conduct experiments simulating the Earth's atmosphere in an artificial way.
Mm-hmm.
You get the food, you don't have contact to the outside world. So a very interesting study, and after doing that for a few years, they have abandoned the project.
Okay. What was the result of that?
Oh, the results were quite well published in various journals.
Mm-hmm.
And say, for example, when you live in isolation,
mm-hmm.
What are the problems? You try to do something, what you call in an indiscriminate way. What happens? How it affects you, how it affects the plants, how it affects the animals. So it's basically the replication of the natural atmosphere, natural biosphere of the Earth in an artificial way. So that's why our Earth is Biosphere 1 and they have named it as Biosphere 2.
Okay.
And that's a very, very interesting site. I was lucky to see it many years back.
Okay.
And that's a good experience.
So now due to chemical hazard and other activities being carried out, how that is having impact on the biosphere and especially on the smallest like algae and others, flora fauna that have in the biospheres?
You see, what happens when we are handling various types of hazardous materials?
Mm-hmm.
Now people, as a layman, people are not actually aware. What they do is, if they are working somewhere on the land, they just dispose everything right on the spot.
Okay.
Okay. It affects a large number of living organisms.
Mm-hmm.
If you are dumping a huge amount of chemicals, say for example, when you have the radioactive leakage,
mm-hmm.
now the radiation is so much and it affects from generation to generation. So the safe disposal is very, very important. The safe handlings of any type of material is very important. So you need to have a scientific way of management. It scientific way of management doesn't mean that it will be only managed by the scientist. The local stakeholders, the people who have been living, they have a lot of traditional knowledge how to maintain their ecosystems.
Mm-hmm.
If some people are living inside the forest, and those people who are living in the forest, they are the best people, they know how to manage the forest.
Okay. So, given this choice, people, because we are having now the number of organic, everywhere the experiment is organic food, organic lifestyle, many more new things scientists and coming from. Try to understand this, but before that, we take up a call from the Rajasthan. Good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
Yeah, go ahead, please ask your question.
But I would like to request you, please reduce the volume of your TV set so that we can hear you. I think
they are not able to.
Okay, sir.
Yeah.
So the experiment is going on this line that organic food, organic things. So how this thing, if it be, it will take up it as a, for large scale, large level. So that will mitigate some problem which we are facing nowadays.
You see, for the number of people.
Okay.
On
we
the
have
part,
another call from Uttar Pradesh.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
Good afternoon, sir. Sir, my question is to the biodiversity and the fly ashes. As a student of development studies, I would like to ask, sir, how can we prevent the biodiversity and what is the bad effect of fly ashes?
Fly ash, which is coming out from these thermal power plants, is one of the biggest challenge, right? And what the people are doing right now is, I visited some of the power plants of NTPC, and the what they do is, now they are using the fly ash for making bricks. That's the only thing which they are using, and they are also making these fly ash ponds where they use
and
it.
Fly ash bricks are very of good quality.
Yes, they are of very good quality. Yeah. Only point is, it needs to be tested before, if somebody is making a house, it needs to be tested in proper scientific
test
way.
Test on this ground.
Because sometimes people say that it emits some sort of radiation, but I don't go by that story. But it's when you have those fly ash and everything is coming out. It needs to be tested before you make
certainly
it.
For the precautionary measure, we need to do some things.
And also the safe disposal of this fly ash is very, very important. If you go from the site, these are so small particles, it also affects the plants around. So only way which is going in the area is that you go for sufficient afforestation or planting of a large number of tree in that area.
Okay.
Yes.
So we have another call from Maharashtra. We take up the question, call. And good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
Yes, I want to ask the question that how the percentage of carbon dioxide can be minimized?
Okay. How the percentage of carbon dioxide could be minimized?
Yes.
And what steps could be taken?
Yes, that's a very good question. The best is to change our lifestyle, which is very, very important. Rather than using individual cars or huge air-conditioned things, changing our lifestyle is one thing. Huge public transport. Okay, you can pull the cars. You can use all modern, switch off the computer, which is not in use. Don't use the electricity when you don't need it. So these are the way by which you can reduce the carbon footprint in the atmosphere.
Okay. We have another call from West Bengal. Good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question.
Huh?
Yeah, please ask your question.
What are the reasons of annual inflation and mention the productive mention of it?
I can't understand.
Can you repeat your question? We are not able to.
Ecological.
No, repeat your question, please. Please repeat your question.
Of ecological imbalance and mention of the protecting nature of it.
I think there are some problem in audios. That's why we are not able to hear you. Okay, I think got disconnected. Something the question related to ecosystem, I think, how to make a balance between ecosystem and...
Yeah, to make a balance between the ecosystem is, you see, you need to know their concept of green living, which is very, very important.
Yeah, greenhouses, green living, green city.
Green living is very, very important.
Okay.
So you can, have a very, very good way of life by not overusing the things. Like in United States, there will be only two persons living in a house, but the air conditioner will be on throughout 365 days.
Okay.
So it emits the huge amount of carbon dioxide, and it damages the whole living ecosystem because it affects our atmosphere.
Okay. But now there are some kind of sensor being used that if people people are inside the house, their air conditioner will work, otherwise it will get switched off. So this kind of mechanism, technological solution will help.
Yeah, you need new technology and everything to combat this climate change.
Okay. So the green living, greenhouses will help us to...
Greenhouses. Greenhouses are different.
Okay.
Greenhouses means these are the poly houses or glass houses which is being used in the colder countries to trap the sunlight so that the inside of the house remains hot. That is the greenhouse.
Okay.
Green living is you try to... there is a call from Bihar.
Okay. Good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question. जी सवाल पूछिए.
हेलो जी, मेरा सवाल था.
हाँ हाँ पूछिए.
कि मतलब ग्रीन हाउस ये क्या कैसे अपना काम करता है?
क्या है?
ग्रीन हाउस कैसे काम करता है?
ओके,
ग्रीन हाउस कैसे काम करता है? देखिए, ग्रीन हाउस जो देयर इज अ सेइंग कॉल्ड ग्रीन हाउस इफेक्ट. जैसे कि आप ऐसा करिए, घर के चारों तरफ शीशा लगा दीजिए, और शीशा लगाने के बाद जो ऊपर से जो सनलाइट आता है, वो सनलाइट वो शीशे के घर में बिल्कुल ट्रैप हो जाता है. ओके. वो ट्रैप होने के बाद जो उसका हीट जनरेट होता है वो वापस ऊपर नहीं जाता है, उसी का अंदर रहता है. ये ज्यादातर विदेशों में यूज होता है या हिंदुस्तान के ठंडे इलाके में यूज होता है, क्योंकि उसमें जो गर्मी है वो टेम्परेचर जो है उसमें मेंटेन रहता है काफी हाई. तो इसीलिए
तो ग्लास जो यूज करते हैं वो भी दैट इज ऑफ सम डिफरेंट काइंड.
नहीं, लोग पॉलिथीन का भी यूज करते हैं. जैसे लद्दाख में जाएंगे लोग उसको पॉलिथीन का यूज करते हैं, ग्लास का भी यूज करते हैं. तो उसको इसीलिए ग्लास हाउस इफेक्ट इसलिए बोलते हैं क्योंकि वो जो अल्ट्रा जो रेडिएशन होता है वो रेडिएशन को ट्रैप करके रख लेता है.
ओके.
तो इसीलिए उसको ग्लास ग्रीन हाउस बोलते हैं.
ओके. और जो आप बता रहे हैं चारों ओर से ग्लास
है,
तो चारों ओर से या ईस्ट और वेस्ट से भी अगर किया जाए ग्लास का प्रयोग, तो इज दैट सफिशिएंट है?
हाँ, एक तो आपका पौधे के लिए
कमिंग
एंड पौधे के लिए आपको लाइट चाहिए और पौधे के लिए हीट चाहिए. अगर ये चारों तरह से अगर आप अगर कहीं एक अपना मकान भी ले लेंगे, चारों तरह अगर ग्लास फिट कर लेंगे, गर्मियों में आप उसका अंदर बैठ नहीं सकते, इतना गर्मी होगा, क्योंकि वो हीट एक बार ट्रैप हो जाता है तो वो बाहर नहीं जाता है, इसलिए वो रहता है.
ओके. वी हैव अनदर कॉल फ्रॉम महाराष्ट्र. गुड आफ्टरनून फ्रेंड, प्लीज आस्क योर क्वेश्चन.
गुड आफ्टरनून सर.
जी, सवाल पूछिए.
हाउ द फार्मर कैन बी यूज फॉर द बायो डीजल प्रोडक्शन फ्रॉम द अल्गी.
Okay, how the farmers can use the biodiesel from algae?
Yeah.
Yes, the farmers, you see, you are from Maharashtra. We have conducted a very good successful training program on sea farming in the Konkan region. Because land is very, very expensive, we don't want to use fertile land, so we want to use the sea water for growing these algae so that it uses the enormous sunlight you have available in the Indian coast, and you have a large amount of seawater which is available. Carbon dioxide is already present. So the algae which is there, the sea algae, it grows luxuriantly inside the seawater. You can harvest this and then subsequently you can process it for the production of biofuel.
Okay. We have another call from Rajasthan. Good afternoon, friend. Please ask your question. Yeah, go ahead, please ask your question. Okay. Okay, we have call from Andhra Pradesh. Good afternoon, friend, please ask your question.
Yes, I would like to ask that how the government of India can formulate its policy so that it's more environment friendly. And as India is a growing superpower, how do you see that we strike a balance between
industrial development as well as, you know, ecological balance.
Right, right.
So, yes, the government of India can only form the policy. You know, you have a Ministry of Environment and Forest. They make the policy and they try to implement it. But it is the people of the country. It is we people. We need to be aware. We are the best custodians of the society. We are the best custodians of our forest.
Yeah.
We are the best custodian of our bioresources. The basically the government will form a policy just to implement it, but it's you know how the government policies are being implemented.
Yeah.
So it's very important for us to be aware and to be careful.
And government are open to take input from all the
sections
and all
very
the
person,
all walk of the life. So I think they are doing their job. We need to also
do
job.
Our job.
And so, with this word, we conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on behalf, I also thank Dr. Dirmandhu Sahu for giving such a wonderful lecture. Thank you very much.